Okay, check. Okay, we good now? We good now? We can,
Are we
okay,
good?
I see the bar moving. I see the bar moving. We good. Hello.
Okay. Hi.
Hello. How are y'all beautiful Pepples doing?
Hello.
Is it Pepples time? It's Pepples time.
And Kitty's here too. It's Pepples and Kitty.
Just get me when they're scuffed to start the stream.
Yeah.
Pain. Little pain. How's everyone doing today? Thank you for the ride of punch. I forgot I moved the sound notification. How's everyone doing today?
Hello.
How's your mama? I don't know where I was going with that, but fuck it. Hello.
Yeah, I don't see the. Yeah, I had to reload the browser because I couldn't see the chat. It wasn't working for me.
How's your mama there? Yeah. It's another Sunday. Be there as we are here.
Be there.
Be there.
You know the YouTube group too.
You know, oddly enough, I didn't. You know what? I heard it as a Second Life gesture first before the YouTube poop. Like, everyone would spam that shit and be like, and that's how I memorized, like, be there, the Dallas Sally.
But yeah, it was,
the Dallas Motor exploded. We're there.
But yeah, it's basically YouTube Hank of the Hill. I love that one.
Hank of the Hill. The Dallas Motor Exploded with the cleaners and bulbers and cleaners and bunners.
Seeking.
Seeking. Oil painters.
Boggle.
The Dallas Motor Exploded is reading. You've nasty position. Good.
Oh, God.
You know what? Fuck it. Hold on. Hold on. What? Ah, think of it right a kick. Hold on. You know what? Hold on.
I'm up.
Yeah. We have stumbled into a new tradition. Hold the fuck on.
Yes, do it, son.
Oh, good.
Do it.
On air. Durham Rockers. Yep, that's the guy.
Yep.
What's the exact name of it?
Hank of the Hill.
Hank of the Hill, hell yeah.
Yeah.
I gotta turn on system audio one quick. Click.
Yes. It's after the.
I'm not gonna play the whole thing. I just want to play the Dallas Motor Expo part.
Yeah, it's after the intro.
Hey, we're gonna skip ahead a little bit.
It's near the beginning, but skip the intro.
I tell you, I hate Nancy. It's a beautiful day. Yay.
Sunday.
And Saturday. It's the ninth
annual Dallas Motor Expo.
Be there. As the biggest stage of all is Hedgers and Clippers on
Sunday.
Cutting technology. Sea King. Oil paintings. Sea King. Don't miss the Dallas Motor Expo. Be there.
That'll never get old, I swear to God.
I know, right?
That'll never get old. It's like a functioning FNAF animatronic. Yeah, I can see that. I can see that.
It sounds like Foxy malfunctioning.
Yep, I can see that. Well,
yep.
It's another week. Oil paintings.
Seeking.
The Dallas Motor Expo, the Hedgers and Clippers and Sunday.
Sunday.
And Saturday. This is like fucking, let's just understate like, Saturday. We want you to be here on Sunday, because Saturday and
Sunday. And Saturday.
Just give some fuck about Saturday. We want you here on Sunday. Good shit.
I know. Oh my God.
Let me crack my knucks. Ah, oh, that felt good. All right, ladies and gentlemen, it's another week of litigation. Because we did the thing, we did the investigative thing last time, and now we are gonna go to the trial, and we're gonna be inevitably thrown a curveball that will.
We're gonna be finishing this case.
And we're gonna probably inevitably be fed a curveball that will piss us the fuck off.
Yep.
Probably because as soon as we thought, oh, we have evidence.
Given the revelation the last time.
Gonna come in and it turns out, yes, there was poison in that tea. How is that possible? And then eat him.
And the first victim was fucking Olive Green's lover. Like, god damn it.
Like, yay, let's poison everybody. That'll be fun. Yay. Wee.
Yay.
Yay. All right. Just want to make a quick note before we start, guys. I would appreciate it if you are going to be, if you are considering dropping some subs or some bits on the stream today, I'm going to ask you to not do that. And instead, go ahead and type !throne in the chat, and you will get the link to my throne, and you'll notice there is a featured item, as you can see right there in the bottom left of the stream. I'm trying to raise money for some fresh RAM on my computer because the RAM sticks I currently have are about to die. And if they die, we can't do this show. So if you'd like So if you would like to contribute to the fund so we can keep the beast of my PC alive so we can bring you more litigation, please consider it. Again, not obligatory. No one's forcing you to fucking donate money to me. You know, like, I would rather prefer you keep the money yourself. But if you want to contribute to the funds, it's there. Go ahead and give it a look-ski. But, hey. That being said, we are now about to enter the threshold of the courtroom, and we are about to deal with some initial bullshit, as you tends to do.
Yep. Sounds about right.
The memoirs of the clouded Kotaro. Kotaro.
Kotaro. Oh. 23rd February, 9:23 a.m. The Old Bailey defendant's antechamber. We're not on the trial yet, so don't play the thing yet.
Oh, we're not in it yet?
No.
Okay, I was about to play it, huh? But I do have to play this.
I like it, Kudgy.
No, wrong one. There you go.
There we go.
Jesus! He's in my face!
Extreme close-up!
Just like fucking... Like you. Wayne's World, party time. Excellent.
Oh my god.
Is he a cat again?
This is it then, Mr. Narahodo.
Yes, it's time to put an end to this now. To the miserable curse that has been plaguing Mr. Natsume. To everything.
And in my own small way, I shall do everything I can to help you.
I always appreciate your help, Miss Susato.
Suffering Suzuki, selfishly sidelined!
Good morning to you too, Mr. Natsume.
Good morning! Good morning, locum student, Mr. Naruhodo Esquire! Listen to you two chatting away happily as the main player of today's trial isn't here! Why would you do that? Why?
Oh dear, we didn't mean to cause offense, Mr. Natsume. I thought perhaps that because you had your eyes shut so tightly you were meditating, finding inner calm. It seemed wrong to disturb you.
Le Poggers, 15 bits from Heartless Doom. Hey Doom, how you doing? Feel like I should repeat it just so you know. If you wanted to donate subs or bits today, I'm going to tell you don't do that. Instead, go to my throne page, just type !throne in the chat. And donate to the featured item, which you can see in the bottom left, which is RAM that I need to keep my computer alive because the RAM I currently have is about to die.
Yeah, so give him.
So if
money.
You'd like to contribute so we can keep the stream going, please consider checking out the throne and donating to the RAM if you would. Right?
Yeah. Not obligatory.
I mean, just do it out of the kindness of your heart if you want to. Otherwise, it's whatever. We just appreciate y'all being here and enjoying the content, you know?
Yeah, give him the monies.
The monies.
I was waiting. What's the matter, Mr. Natsume? You seem different somehow today. Well, naturally, it's because I've attained spiritual enlightenment, and yet...
You were still perturbed by us not acknowledging you. Company Master, how you doing? Yeah.
Hello.
The path of literature, you see, is a journey to discover one's own death. Or such like. That's the sort of morning conversation I was hoping for. That's why I had my eyes shut.
I, missed the signs, I'm afraid. Somehow. You'll have to forgive me.
And you mustn't talk of your path leading to death, Mr. Nostime.
That was just an example.
Oh yes, there it is. Inner calm.
You barely came to see me at all yesterday. I was sure you abandoned me and returned to our beautiful long-lost homeland.
We've not even been in Great Britain a week yet.
Yes, well, anyway. I intend to set everything straight in court today. I'm determined to uncover the truth.
I've actually reached an important decision myself.
Oh, what sort of decision?
I shall fill you in after the trial.
Right.
It would seem... Mr. Sholmes isn't coming today after all. It's a very clever message, I think. My dear fellows, you must win this battle on your own merits.
It's a very clear message, I think, that he's overslept again.
That would be him.
The great detective, my arch nemesis. Long may he stay away, if you ask me.
Defendant, your legal representative, the trial is about to begin. Make your way to the courtroom immediately.
Oh, God.
Okay, when the green text shows up, don't read it. Don't read it.
Today, once again, we face the Reaper. And when the Reaper stands for the prosecution, the defendant's fate is sealed. But I don't believe in that legend any more than I believe in Soseki-san's curse. The truth is hidden here somewhere, and I won't let it escape me. I have to keep believing in my client and keep fighting to the very end. That's all.
Out of curiosity, have you ever watched the anime series Sherlock Hound?
Nope.
That sounds interesting. You mean you're telling me Sherlock Holmes is a dog?
Oh, God.
That sounds fun.
Was he bark? Scrap McGrath of crime dog?
No, he's Hound of the Baskervilles.
Oh, right. No,
don't read it. Don't read it.
In the criminal justice system, all defendants are innocent until proven guilty, either by confession, plea bargain, or trial by jury. This is one of those trials.
All right. Okay, you read it now.
23rd February, 9:40 a.m., the Old Bailey courtroom.
In the name of Her Majesty the Queen, I hereby declare this court to be in session. I call upon the counsels for the prosecution and defense to declare their willingness to proceed.
The prosecution is ready. Yes, the defense is ready.
Very good. And now I call upon the six ladies and gentlemen of the jury, chosen by lot to represent the will of the people in this trial. Are you ready to proceed?
Excuse me.
Absolutely. Justice will be done, you mark my words.
I feel obliged to say I feel especially unruthless on days when I might have a sitting just right.
Oh, well, I wonder if you could adjust my hair for me. Please, be as ruthless as you like.
Thieves deserve to die, if you ask me. Especially gas thieves. I've no sympathy for the man at all.
Get no sympathy from...
Look, I said it yesterday and I'll say it again now. I don't have time for this. I got my own problems.
Oh, may the Lord show us all the light here and lead his flock to a righteous verdict again today as I stroke my beard for the 500th time.
God damn it!
It's fluffy like sheep as the shepherd of our Lord. He'll direct us to the correct verdict. And it's very interesting.
No, Lord Von Zeeks, what can you tell us? The prosecution's report, please, for the court. In relation to the theory expounded by the defense yesterday, regarding the defendant's tea.
Is that beer made of cotton?
Yes, it's made of cotton.
Oh, no, you mean the jars.
Oh, yes, it is cotton. Yes, as I am not stroking my beard, but you can see the fluffiness. And...
So he does have the results.
I know, Jiren. Oh, yes, my beard is soft and fluffy. Feels like cotton, but it's not.
Before the prosecution delivers the black news about the black tea belonging to the black god in the dock. That's a lot of black.
Oh my god.
Pray, allow me a moment to savor a liquid of a more sanguine hue. In fact, I'll defer to the good detective for the report. Here's to you, Inspector.
Yes, sir. Thank you, sir. As indicated by the defense, we found a bar of soap just outside the victim's window in the snow. There was indeed a frozen reddish liquid and a little depression on top of it.
Yes, that's the tea. That's what Mr. Natsumi brought with him that night.
Well, the brains at the yard analyzed it, and yes, you're right. It was tea. And there wasn't a trace of strychnine or any other toxic substance in it.
No poison at all.
In other words, the tea that the defendant brought with him to the victim's room is innocent. It's in the clear.
What a revelation! Hell yeah.
Yes.
As I suspected. This makes it quite clear. The defendant, Mr. Suseki Natsumi, is blameless here.
What?
Of course.
My learned friend is jumping to conclusions again. A typical Nipponese reaction.
Racist.
What? Yes, it's true. No poison was found in the few drops of liquid recovered from the soap on the window ledge. But what logic is that? Would you take a drop from the Thames and conclude that the water in the ocean isn't salty?
My word, the water in the ocean is extremely salty, Counsel.
No shit, Judge.
Yes, this is actually a prequel to the Ace Attorney universe. This is, this is Phoenix Wright's predecessor.
No, yeah.
It's predecessor, yeah. Ancestor, predecessor, so, whatever you like.
Yeah, yeah. Well, the reason why...
What is a man?
The reason why I say ancestor is because they share the same last name, Naruhodo.
Exactly. Unfit for drinking. Just as the victim's tea was on the night in question, as the court had already heard. Bitter was the precise words from the lips of William Shamspear. Whom the prosecution now calls back to the stand.
Oh, great. Him again.
This is a voice that I dread doing.
That's the character I dread seeing.
Very well. I will uphold the prosecution's request.
Mr. Shamspear.
Yes, it sounds like we're going to have another confrontation with our theatrical friend. He's not our friend!
No, he's not.
Fuck that guy. He's not a friend. I'm not your friend, pal.
I'm not your buddy, guy. He's not your buddy, friend.
He's not your friend, pal.
Your friend, guy. You regret this day, friend. He's not your friend, buddy.
I love that bit.
I know. There he is.
Mr. William Shamspear, the victim of his despicable crime.
Oh, heaven. Oh, hell. You command me to remember. Forsooth, 'twas I, Shamspear, did have a belly full of the foul fluid given, in mine innocence.
Yes, but as was revealed in yesterday's proceedings, the witness is not as innocent as we had perhaps first been led to believe.
By using bars of soap such as this, he has been stealing gas from the supply company, yes.
One may smile and smile, and be a villain. Forsooth, 'twas I, Shamspear, did have a room full of the sweet fuel given.
That's right. Fellow jurors, don't forget. This man is a rotten thief. I'm forgotten. Kept all that about the ice cores a tidy secret, didn't you? Should've owned up sooner.
Arrest him, I say. Arrest him at once, and let him feel the sting in my tail.
Oh, indeed. By dint of violent, cowardly means have I plotted to further mine own ends, I confess. Else would not pardon my sins. Of that I am sure.
If you acknowledge your wrongdoing, what exactly are you doing here?
Cowards die many times before their deaths. And for a coward such as I, death be well deserved. But would that still be a greater crime passeth unpunished? For lo, the hairy-faced gentleman of Father East and Verona did contrive to poison me.
Stop!
Stop flailing, you bitch!
But there was no poisoning tea found in your room. The police have attested to that. What the defense would assert is an inconsistency will quickly be cleared up by the witness's testimony. Is that not so, Mr. Shamspear?
Verily, my liege. I would most gladly speak.
Very well.
Very well. Let the witness testify to explain this inconsistency. Tell the court why it is that poison apparently entered your body, though none was found in the tea.
All right.
We'll bite.
Witness testimony.
Tea inconsistency.
The Japanese man did come to my chamber with tea brewed in a pot. It wasn't my cup alone that the wicked miscreant secretly poured his wicked poison. Whilst feigning distraction in our debate, ne'er did a drop of his own drink pass his lips. When he departed by and by, I did use the tea that remained in his cup to make my coins of ice. Thus, there's no surprise that poison be not found in the tea I did pour into the molds of soap.
Just... the voice I'm giving him makes him even more punchable.
I know.
The poison was slipped into the cup after the tea had been poured.
The normal way for poison to be administered, in my experience.
Quite. Otherwise, it would be disastrous if the poisoner were to mix up the cups, for instance.
But no poison bottle was found at the scene. Because, quite simply, the Nipponese took the bottle back to his own room.
You're forgetting something.
Did you check his room?
We had the teacups to prove it.
The absence of a vessel containing the poison only becomes problematic when considering suicide.
This guy isn't a clown, he's the entire circus. He already did that catchphrase in the in the first game.
Yep.
I knew that. By now, it should be perfectly clear. A bar or two of cheap soap is wholly insufficient to wash the deep stains of guilt from the accuser's hands.
Sirs, madam, it is true that I, Shamspear, be a common thief of gas.
But, listen here, ladies and gentlemen.
He's slipping.
Wherefore would I lie? Verily, I have no cause. I have naught to lose.
Well,
I do declare.
Thank you for your testimony, witness. Counsel, proceed with the cross-examination.
Yes, my lord.
Cross-examination.
You are not a clown. Oh, no, wait.
No, to your future career in the circus.
It seems my learned Nipponese friend regales. Did I say trend?
It seems that my Nipponese friend has regaled us with such witticisms.
To your future career in the circus.
Love it.
Now, go to statement 3, but don't press. Because, examine the teacups.
Presento.
Examine the teacups.
Yee. Whoa, what the? Why is it spinning? Crap, hold on. I can fix
examine
this.
Examine the teacups.
Oh, hold on, it's like, I think, hold on.
One has a red
it
ring around
it. It won't stop spinning. Hold on.
It's drifting? Oh shit.
Yeah, drift. I think it was pressed to the right when I... There we go.
Okay. There's a red ring, see?
Oh shit, wrong button. Hold on.
Now examine the one with the red ring around it, see?
This must be the cup that Mr. Shamspear was drinking from then. It's stained on the inside.
Tea does that, I'm afraid. Even green tea.
Oh really? I've never noticed before.
You never noticed?
Well, I never leave it in the cup long enough to leave a mark. I like to gulp it down. Drink tea while it's hot, that's the Japanese way, isn't it?
Oh dear, so many people seem to have the wrong idea about our culture, and most of them are Japanese.
Oof. Big oofs. Ooh. Big oofs in the chat. Big oofs.
Oof. But, yeah. One teacup has a red ring on its interior, while the other is clean. Once updated, present the pair of teacups on statement 3.
It didn't update.
What?
It didn't update.
Oh, this is the teacup from which Mr. Natsume was drinking.
Yes, unlike the other one, the inside of the cup is completely clean.
I suppose he must have drunk the contents before the tea had a chance to leave a mark.
I always gulp it down, too.
Sorry, Mr. Narihodo.
Well, if you just sip it little by little, it goes cold.
Clearly, I shall have to instruct you in the proper way to take tea.
There it goes.
There we go. Now present it.
Beep. Beep, bop, boop.
And...
beep. Beep, bop, boop, son.
Because it was drunk. Because the tea was drunk that day.
You claim that Mr. Natsume didn't drink a drop of tea on the night in question. But that's impossible. How? Chop logic. What is this, ye dark, ye clad friend? The two teacups from the scene, one used by the victim and the other by the defendant, have a clear difference between them. One that represents incontrovertible proof. Yep, Ace Attorney on the nose with the names, that's to be true. Incontrovertible? What
incontrovertible.
Difference? Incontrovertible?
Yes.
Look at the inside of the cups. Just here, there's a clearly visible ring. Yes, a tea ring. Commonplace enough.
Indeed. Such stains are called too early when one leaves tea in the cup for a while.
And yet, Mr. Natsume's cup has no such ring.
Good lord, you're right! It's completely clean!
And prithee, sir, what makest thou of it? Exactly what Mr. Natsume told the court yesterday. The Japanese saying he quoted.
Drink tea. That's hot!
Yep.
That's right. Yes. The jittery Mr. Natsume was true to his usual self that night and drank his tea in no time.
Okay, the fucking beady eyes.
If, as you claim in your testimony, he didn't drop the dip.
Yeah.
If, as you claim in your testimony, he didn't touch a drop of tea, a ring would have developed on the inside of his cup as well after the several hours the tea was left standing. In short, Mr. Shamspear, you clearly lied to the court. To a nunnery.
He's losing it. Oh, what now?
As a rule, I fill my hallowed chalice up to 7 times during any one trial.
You're no good dose, sir.
Okay, he's already done. Okay, hold on. He's done it twice already.
Yeah, you're no good dose, sir.
So I feel like, chat, if you can help us...
Oh my gosh! He is Godot, because Godot drinks 7 cups of coffee during court. So now, Zeke drinks 7 times...
I'm gonna need chat to help me keep count, because I'm gonna forget. He's already served himself twice.
Yeah.
We need to verify if he gets past 7.
But yeah, he is Godot, because Godot drinks coffee 7 times during trial. So, yeah.
You might want to keep that information to yourself. Yet on occasion, tedium distracts me and I pour more times than I intended until the bottle is dry.
Because apparently the bottle is bottomless.
That's 3.
Your drinking habits are fascinating, but irrelevant. On the contrary, they illustrate the fickleness of human memory. To William Shamspear.
Yes, my liege.
So you previously stated that you made the coins of ice from the leftover tea in the accused cup. Could it be that you were perhaps mistaken? Could it be that, yes, perhaps there was some tea remaining in the small teapot left at the scene? A fact that had vanished from your memory until now?
Yeah, because you implanted it in his brain, you fuckwit!
Yeah! Ugh.
In faith, my liege, thou art a magician. For verily, 'tis as though thou hast seen with thine own eyes that night.
What?
Forsooth, I was mistook. I did did plan to use tea from the Japanese fellow's cup, but lo, when I looked, 'twas empty. And thus I did use the dregs that fested in the teapot, as my liege suggest. As you've just suddenly remembered now that you made a mistake before? No. Are we supposed to believe that? Objection. People's memories are imperfect, my learned friend. Which is why we rely on evidence instead.
Obviously not bleeding, he's wearing gloves. But then again, that's still, you know.
Yeah.
I feel like he's done it a million times before to the point where he's engineered it where it won't happen.
Yep.
Which is why we rely on evidence instead. But in any case, it makes no difference. The victim's most recent testimony tells us two things of note. Firstly, that the poison was put into the victim's teacup only. And secondly, that this spoiled cup was not the source of the insipid ice coins that bewitched this court.
Where are the clown boobs? Wrong game. Wrong game in the series, I should say.
Yeah, wrong game. That's in the sixth game.
Yeah, and that's on the 3DS.
Yeah, it's for a Spirit of Justice, I believe. What?
He literally person came into the chat just looking for the clown boobs, and since the clown boobs aren't here, they left.
Oh God. Besides, they fake.
You realize that changes nothing though, right?
Yeah.
And porn artists will spin that no matter what.
Hey, she still got the cake though. She got that ass.
Nah. Porn artists, the balloons mean nothing. They are still huge.
She got
they
the
mean
cake.
Nothing.
Cake for...
That does mean nothing.
Prosecution makes a fine summary of the facts. Furthermore, that testimony remains valid and in full support of the established facts. In other words... The inconsistency claimed by the defense simply does not exist.
Jack it off.
What does this mean, then?
I do declare, it means there's no issue with the gas thief's testimony.
Apart from the bit about thieving gas, obviously.
My lords, ladies and gentlemen of the jury, I do solemnly swear, after I did dine at Grub's Grubbery Alehouse that night, naught did pass my lips, but the black tea given me by the Japanese would back be stooped as low as death.
And on what did you dine, sir?
Why, I did partake of my favorites. A broth as would be called soup, and a leaf as would be called salad. As insalubrious a menu as the establishment where it was served. But you gods will give us some faults to make us men. Willingly would I suffer what punishment is seen fit to serve a wicked thief of gas. But, I pray ye wise and noble fellows, ne'er forget the simple truth. That be one thing, and this be another. Oh. Is all, your humble servant Shamspear doth entreat you. Punish the Japanese fellow for his sins.
Fuck you, dude.
I'm going to take that scepter and ram it up your ass.
No lube.
Ram it up so far as he's detorting that jewel.
My lord.
Toseki? Oh, it's you.
If I may speak, my lord. Yes, Mr. Foreman. I believe we may have been duped by that rotten defense lawyer. By me?
Not again.
I hate... Not again. When they bring it back onto us, I just sit there and just...
Not again. We're doing this again?
Like, I hate to say it, but as great as these games are, they are kind of engineered to cause anxiety.
Yes. Like... I do declare you may be right.
We all know the wife there was making coins of ice to keep himself warm.
We're doing this again, are we?
But this lawyer law says if he's stealing gas, he deserves a dose of poison, eh? He's been leading us up the garden path, that's what he's been doing.
I really never said anything like that.
But what we just heard from the victim there has opened eyes again. We've reached a decision this time. We won't be swayed from it. The court acknowledges the position of the jury foreman. And will duly hear the jury's findings.
What? No! You can't yet!
Ladies and gentlemen of the jury, you will state your decisions now.
Guilty. Fuck you. Fuck you.
Fuck.
Guilty. Fuck you. Guilty. What?
Guilty. No.
Guilty. Y'all motherfucking.
Come on.
You
guys suck.
I thought the bee lady would be on our fucking side for this shit.
I know. What? It's like, lady, you're the owner of the gas company. At the end of the day, lady, your gas was stolen.
I hereby declare the jury to be in one accord.
Hello, DM Chaos. How you doing? Oh, happy day. Stop dancing. You fucking.
Oh, no. These hips don't lie.
They do. Because that dance is horrible. Fucking, bruh. Fucking,
clip that. Oh my god, clip that.
It's so horrible. How is this happening? My lord, the defense asserts its right to carry out the summation examination.
Please.
Very well. The court upholds the defense's right.
Typical. My learned friend is unable to accept the obvious truth.
This trial will therefore enter its second summation examination immediately. Jurors, the court calls upon each of you to state the grounds upon which you find the defendant guilty of the crime for which he is charged.
You walked into a Phoenix Wright game. That's what you walked into.
Judicial findings.
The jurors' contentions. Here we go.
I'm a man of logic, me. And having considered all the evidence, the defendant must logically be guilty. You didn't consider shit.
Come on, fair play. I do agree that the gas is far too expensive. I can quite understand why the man would want to avoid paying. Says you, you classist bitch!
I swear to fucking God, if they let me have a steel chair in this courtroom, I'd be whacking every juror. Your stuff explodes and it can poison you. It's absolutely lethal gas is.
Gas doesn't come for free. It costs a fortune to deliver around the city and maintain the pipes.
Truth be told, but the one wife serves up for me is a little sketchy at times.
See, now that statement... That statement sticks with me.
Yep.
If nothing else passed the victim's lips that night, there's no other explanation, is there? As, I feared my beard for the 500th time. It's soft and,
snuggly.
Women can use me as a pillow. Just rest your face on my face. Or your legs, whichever you prefer. But it's very comfortable.
Are you done?
You know I'm not done.
Yes,
God damn
just
it.
Continue to just enjoy the feeling of my beard. It's like cotton. Look at my eyebrows. They look like cotton as well. It's
oh my god.
Very nice. It's very soft. It's very nice.
Okay, I'm done. For now, anyway. I'll probably do it again in like 5 seconds.
I do feel that Pop's personal opinion about gas and its supplies influence decisions somewhat. But never mind.
No, you really should mind.
The truth is, our counter-argument wasn't as unassailable as we'd hoped. And Mr. Shanspear was poisoned. There can be no doubt of that.
Then how are we supposed to turn this around?
I think we need to establish the method by which Mr. Shamstor was actually poisoned. Our only hope is to demonstrate how has the English. Our only hope to demonstrate that to the court incontrovertibly.
But surely almost impossible at this stage.
If we don't manage it, though, Mr. Natsume will
be found guilty.
No delays, counsel. Proceed with our summation examination.
All right, who am I pitting here?
Jury.
God, I hate that smarmy face in the background.
I hate it.
Fuck off. Defense is rebuttal.
Number four, can you elaborate?
Yeah, can.
Wait, number four? Number four, can you elaborate?
Hold it.
Can we please refrain from all this talk of gas?
There's an all-out attack underway here, in case you haven't noticed, against my company's gas. And I'm supposed to sit there and take it, am I? I don't think so.
He's really buzzing now.
Whoop, whoop, that's the sound of the bees.
Whoop, whoop, that's the sound of the police.
All I've heard about our wonderful fuel is explosions and poisonings. What about electricity, hmm? What about getting electrocuted? What about that?
Are we there? Wait, are we there yet in the friggin'... Have electricity?
Yeah, they do. A little explosion here, and there's nothing in comparison.
I beg to differ.
An explosion could hardly be described as nothing, but I see the judge knows.
Yeah.
Nevertheless, the theft of your gas is deplorable.
My point exactly, but the gas thieves aren't even the worst of our enemies. We have far more devious reprobates to contend with on a daily basis, you know.
More devious? Who, madam?
Other gas companies, of course.
Other gas companies? Not quite what I was expecting.
We generate gas and we deliver to our customers fair and square.
Indeed. Nobody is questioning that, madame. Altamont is an exemplary gas company.
But there are other unscrupulous gas companies here in London that don't even have any gas at all.
What? But if they don't have any gas, how do they go about selling it to people?
You wouldn't think it possible, would you? But they steal our gas, you see, and sell that. Black market much? Bit the black market, huh?
You steal your gas? How on earth is such a thing possible?
Gas companies like ours deliver gas to people's homes via a network of pipes. But these devious reprobates secretly disconnect our pipes and divert our gas into their own rotten pipes. Aha! Interesting.
I'm actually stroking my beard like the old man because I'm actually thinking.
That's interesting. Then they make a contract with a household supplied by those pipes. And take money from the precious gas that's rightfully ours without us even knowing. They're diverting gas into their own pipes illegally. What a brazen form of theft.
I'm trying to figure out how this applies to us because there isn't a, unless you're like, this is kind of like diverting into saying that the house itself is actually set up to steal, but then they put the meters in, so it makes no sense. So it's
Wait, the handprints on the wall. The handprints. When we visit customers' houses to collect the money from the meters, we always have to check whether or not one of these devious companies has been out there trying to... hey! You!
Hello, sir. Hello.
Halt, what are you saying?
Excuse me. Do you have something to say about that, juror number 3? Oh, golly, you mean me? I'm terribly sorry. I was just thinking to myself. You did catch him off guard there. Thinking about what the lady next to you was saying, correct? I just got a little riled up about it recently, you see. Go on. An Altamont gas worker visited my house the other day to investigate the pipe work. We need to ask for your cooperation while we carry out a secret check of your property, sir, the fellow said. So I let him in, and you know what he did? I'm afraid I have no idea. Please tell us. He proceeded to take one of my lights off the wall. Then he grabbed the exposed mouth at a pipe and started blowing into it.
What?
Huh?
He blew it through the gas pipe?
Explain yourself.
What do you think you're doing, young man? You're giving away company secrets there.
Oh, please. Everybody knows. It was barely nearly the death of me, I can tell you. What do you mean?
I'll explain, if you don't mind. As I said before, these unscrupulous other gas companies connect their customers to our pipe network.
Yes, but how does blowing into the pipes come into it?
Obviously, there's gas in the pipes, and it's a fairly low pressure. By blowing air through the pipe, you can make the pressure drop temporarily. And if you do that, any lights connected to the same pipe will flicker for a moment.
Oh.
Yeah.
Interesting.
That's devious.
Oh, I see. In other words, if upon blowing into the pipe, the lights of an adjacent property that has no contract with the company flicker, you can know that these devious scoundrels have been meddling with the pipes.
Exactly, my lord. That's it in a nutshell. It's the reason why we have teams of workers going around neighborhoods to investigate which lights flicker.
The trouble is, the particular worker who came to my house didn't know the strength of his own breath. He blew down the pipe with all his might, and you can guess what happened, can't you?
Well, if he blew hard, then...
Wait, you mean...
That's right. The lights didn't just flicker, they went along with the...
A power outage.
I pieced it together in my head.
And it releases carbon monoxide, which
No. Yeah, exactly.
Yes.
We're looking at this the wrong way. It's not.
Yeah.
There was never a poisoning because literally for months, this guy's been trying to kill Sozeki by doing. Oh my.
Yeah, he's been trying to kill Nozeki with carbon monoxide poisoning.
This
motherfucker.
Even more reason to hate this bitch.
Yeah.
That's right, the lights didn't just flicker, they went out, along with the stove. Gas pouring into the house.
What a disaster.
The gas supply must have been interrupted briefly because the man blew too hard, so the flames went out.
I'm afraid I yelled at the fella. Are you trying to kill us all? I said...
So by disconnecting a lamp and blowing into the exposed gas pipe, it's possible to extinguish lamps and stoves connected to the same network of pipes. And then when the gas starts flowing again, it just silently seeps into the room.
Mr. Narahodo, I think perhaps...
Yes, this is almost certainly the clue that we've been hoping for.
Yep.
Charter number 3. The defense requested to amend your statement to include that information.
Oh, well, if you like. I don't mind.
Well, I do. That's our company's secret method of identifying the rogues that try to meddle us.
Like I said, my name is widely known already.
Very well, Chair number 3, you will amend your statement accordingly.
Mm-hmm. Yes, my lord. Although I'm not really sure what the point of all this is.
New dialogue.
Blow the water into a gas pipe and you extinguish everything in the house, and then you're in real trouble.
Hit him with 6!
Ba-da-da-ba-ba.
Those two statements clearly contradict each other.
Good gracious! Two statements even for a council!
Juror number 6, did you hear what juror number 3 just said?
Yeah, what? Yes, of course! I heard him mumbling...
Oh, no, sorry. Eh? What? Yes, of course! I heard him mumbling about something or other.
There is another explanation here, I believe. Something besides Mr. Natsumi did in a matter of speaking past the victim's lips on the night in question.
What? What explanation?
I wonder, did the police check the mouth of the gas pipe feeding the wall light at the scene? To see if there were any traces of poison there?
I was curious to see what you floundering would result in this time, but the mouth of a gas pipe? Scotland Yard had enough to do without exploring such irrelevance.
What a piece of work is a man?
What is a man?
God damn it, Shamspear.
Shamspear, you can't say that because you are not a man. You are a fucking murderer.
You're a pussy.
What are you trying to say, Mr. Shamspear?
What speakest thou? Prithee, is it not strange and strange? This is what I say to thee, sir.
Stop!
I thought I'd been quite clear, but let me put it another way. The stretch knife could have been on the mouth of the gas pipe that feeds the wall lamp in your room. And that is how the poison came to enter your body.
Good lord! Are they tasty then, gas pipes? Is that what he's saying?
Oh, was it the gentleman suggesting that the poor man was so desperately hungry he tried to fill his belly with gas?
Are you that dense?
Perhaps no actress would perform a kiss scene with him.
So... Of course they wouldn't! Of course! You look at this man, he does not look attractive. He looks like a perpetual troll face.
That is a burn.
The man is a perpetual pog. You cannot.
Shame, madame. Speaking like fancy.
I assure you, I'm not such a buffoon that I have to kiss pipes. Ah! Miserable little pipe. This is no summation examination. This is a farce. The prosecution will not stand for any more of my learned Nipponese friend's conjecture. To begin with, the lamp in the victim's room is high on the wall. In order to have placed his lips to the pipe that feeds it would have to be a contortionist. These are empty assertions. There is no possible proof that the man did as you say. It's true, I have no proof that Mr. Shamsay put his lips to the pipe. However, I can say with some certainty that on multiple occasions, Mr. Shamsay has been doing something in front of that lamp on his wall. Ta-da! And I have evidence to prove it.
The handprints.
Of course, I mean, you didn't have to say it.
Yep.
All right, you've got our attention, lad. I'd like to see if you're so sure of yourself.
So would I. Let's see this evidence, then. Not that I've got the jury's ear. I need to make this opportunity count. This is the proof that time and time again, Mr. Shamsay stood in front of his gas lamp. What? What are they called? Yes. Skin prints have been found at the scene.
Skin prints, counsel? I've never heard of such things. The Justice Ministry is currently assessing whether or not to permit fingerprints as evidence in court, however.
My lord, this is the exciting new forensic technique developed by the great detective Mr. Sherlock Sholmes. It reveals all the places that Mr. Shamsay touched in his room.
Never seen anything like it. I mean, that's black magic, isn't it?
If anyone could invent something like this, it's that great Sholmes fellow, that's for sure. Maybe he could help. Maybe if he used it on me, he could see how many times I stroke my beard a day. I just like running my hands through it. Very soft. Oh. It's cuddly.
As you.
Oh, I agree. This month's edition of Engineering Thumbs was quite fascinating.
You found skin prints in many places that you would expect. On the table, on the costumes. However, Mr. Shamsay also appears to have been touching some very unexpected places in his room. For example, here. Around the hanging picture there.
Around the hanging picture there, indeed. Multiple prints appear to be visible.
Oh. Well, I wonder, could he have been appreciating the artwork, perhaps?
At first, my colleagues and I thought the same. However, imagine standing with your hands where those prints are, and you would find yourself directly in front of...
I don't believe it.
The gas lamp. Though, the reason why isn't immediately obvious, it's clear that Mr. Shamsay has regularly been standing with his hands to the wall in front of that lamp.
Right, what are you up to, you nut?
Just... Talk about gaslighting. Hey!
You get a point.
I'd ask the court to recall June number 4's earlier statement.
Me? What did I say?
You said that blowing into a gas pipe would make the lights in the entire building flicker. And now, if you recall your number 3 statement...
What? Me nah.
When the gas worker who visited his home blew with too much force into the pipe, it caused all the lights and the gas stove to go out, and gas to start leaking into the rooms.
Yeah, your messages are going through, EG. We can see them. I mean, just focus right now on the story.
Yeah.
However, the simple fact is... If Mr. Shamsay were to have blown hard into the gas pipe here in this room, he could have extinguished every other light and gas stove in the building at will.
Crikey!
Oh, are you suggesting that the man purposely caused the gas to...
Objection!
5.
I think we're up at 6 at this point.
Well, so acknowledge that the prosecution is required to remain silent during a submission examination.
I must toast my learned friend's utter disregard for the letter of the law.
Excuse you, bitch.
What is the meaning of this, Lord Von Zeeks?
This curious photograph of whatever it is presented by the defense. So-called skin prints. Clearly, that cannot be accepted as any form of usable evidence in this case.
Oh, but it's an exciting new forensic technique developed by the great detective.
It's nothing. A mere toy developed by an amateur sleuth with too much time on his hands.
Certainly even research of this nature by the esteemed Mr. Sholmes cannot be recognized by the court as formal evidence.
please, my lord, if I may.
Mrs. Hutto?
It was not the defense's intention to submit the skin prints as formal evidence. We merely wish to present the results of the great detective's investigation of the scene as a tool by which to explain a possibility to the ladies and gentlemen of the jury.
Van Zeeks didn't even expect that shit.
Yep. And if the trial were to come to an end now, we should never learn the truth behind these mysterious handprints that everyone has now seen. I do believe we can allow that to happen, and I'm sure the jurors would agree.
You're right. Whether those strange handprints are a significant clue or not, it's down to us to decide.
Yes.
Juror number three.
Oh, yes. I do declare the great detective's investigation results should absolutely fascinating. And I want to hear what the shady actor fellow has to say about those shady handprints. Let's go! Let's go!
What's the matter with you two? That was foolhardy.
Well, I did say it, didn't I? I don't like to break a promise.
No, wait! You heard his lordship. It's not fair to take him evidence.
Hey! Yeah. The old man with the soft beard is in our corner.
It's even now, bitch! Oh, well done, Mr. Narahodo. It's just one more juror changes his or her mind. Mr. Natsume's trial will have to continue.
Thank you, Mrs. Hato. But I couldn't have done it without you.
Oh no, it was you who identified the clue after all. That is very much your own success. He's shaking!
Oh, lordy, he's shaking!
He's shaking!
Why, Mr. Shamsby, you seem to be losing your composure. He's fucked!
He's shaking! Just one more juror, Mr. Narahodo. You can do it!
Very well, continue, counsel.
Oh, Bruce, fair play. Press.
I was gonna pit. No, press.
All the evidence, you say?
That's right. And there's no room for doubt. It's all pointing at the Japanese man with the big mustache.
Says the Englishman with the bigger mustache. But the defense has demonstrated another possible explanation for the events on the night in question. What do you make of that?
What? Your so-called skin prints?
It's an exciting new forensic investigation technique, developed by the great detective himself.
Alright, take a shot every time someone says exciting new forensic technique.
You'll be plastered by the end of this.
Yep.
The numerous handprints on the wall are clearly out of the ordinary. And if Mr. Shamsby had indeed put his mouth to the gas pipe on the night in question, it can't be denied that there's a possibility that's where the poison was.
Well, yes, I won't deny that's playing on my mind. But as the prosecution rightly says, we should pay no heed to unacceptable forms of evidence. Besides...
Yes?
Even if the fellow has been up to some mischief with the gas pipe dozens of times before, it doesn't mean he got up to the same shenanigans on the night in question, does it?
Oh.
You can't make your case better than that. I'm afraid I can't change my stance.
You do make a very valid point, sir.
That's true. Perhaps I was a little hasty.
No, wait!
Look, you've got your chance here, haven't you? It's time to prove your theory. If you and your Japanese cohorts can, that is.
Just leave our nationality out of this, please, you fucking racist.
Yeah, you racist prick.
Fuck are you?
Mr. Narahodo, if we can't substantiate our position, I'm afraid the jurors that changed their minds before may very well change them back.
What can I do? Is there any more proof I can give here? Can I show that Mr. Shamsby really did blow down the gas pipe on the night in question?
I have supporting testimony.
No, in truth, I don't have evidence to support my theory. However, there is witness testimony that substantiates it.
What's that? Testimony?
It's incredible! Whose testimony? Yes, it's all connected. Everything is linked. A person whose testimony revealed details about the gas in the Garadab residence that night. Namely?
Suseki Natsume!
The man! The myth! The legend! Obviously, I'm talking about the defendant. Mr. Suseki Natsume himself.
The defendant?
At the very beginning of the proceedings here in court yesterday, Mr. Natsume said the following.
My lodgings! There's been a whole series of strange happenings in my lodgings. Even on that fateful night, it happened. When I returned from Mr. Shamspear's room, I lit my gas stove and climbed into bed, but before long, the stove went out. And somebody tried to kill me.
On the night, to you, Sammy.
On the night in question, the gas in the defendant's room went out. So I asked the court, was that a mere coincidence or not?
Good golly!
So that Shamspear fellow blew air into the gas pipe to make the man's stove go out on purpose?
Now hold your horses there. What would he do that for?
We got him. Ladies and gentlemen.
We got him.
Mr. Foreman.
What is it, man?
We cannot allow judgment to be passed whilst this doubt remains. It's true that I don't have conclusive evidence yet. However, you must surely agree, there is more to this case than meets the eye.
Come on.
Fair enough. Like I said at the outset, I'm a man of logic first and foremost.
Yes!
Mans!
Woo!
Baby! It's four jurors lean towards not guilty, my lord. We've overturned the decision. Therefore, the defendant calls for the trial to continue. Baby!
Let's go!
Let's do this.
As the defense has rightfully indicated, the summation examination has concluded with a majority of jurors altering their decisions. Two jury members now called guilty, four now called not guilty. Therefore, the jury's opinion is conflicted, and in accordance with the law of this land, I hereby order the continuation of this trial. Mr. William Shamspear.
My lord, how can thy humble Shamspear serve thee?
What say you in response to the various revelations made during the summation examination?
So God mend me, I do solemnly swear. I recall aught of either, the lamp or the pipe.
Your handprints have made a tidy mess all over the wall there. How do you explain that, eh?
Oh, my face!
Jinx, you owe me a Coke.
I am done with this. The dignity of this great courtroom has been sullied with enough already, Jordan number five. Who, me?
As I went to some pains to point out already, a print from the self-professed detective's toy has no place in a British court of law. As such, whether or not this man did indeed stand before the gas lamp with his hands against the wall remains, at this time, unestablished conjecture. You'll all do well to remember that. But the prosecution must concede that it would be extremely simple to verify. Just order the mouth of the gas pipe feeding that lamp in Mr. Shamsmere's room to be examined. If there are traces of poison there... What appears to be extremely simple is my Nipponese friend's mind. You will recall that in order to check for the presence of the poison in the tea, some remnants of tea were required. Yes. Therefore, it shouldn't be beyond your wit to imagine that even if poison would have been spread on the pipe, it would have completely evaporated by now, making any analysis impossible. I didn't think of that.
In any case, counsel, I fail to see what could possibly have motivated the man to do as you describe. Why on earth would this fellow have wanted to blow air into the gas pipework where he lived?
There's only one possibility that I can think of. And that is...
to use the leaking gas to commit murder.
Order! Order! Council! Precisely whose life do you propose this man was plotting?
Do I even need to say it?
Teammate. Are you serious?
Answer couldn't be simpler. Now we've unraveled the mystery this far. Mr. Shamsby wanted to end the life of this dude.
Not to me.
If a gas lamp were to go out, it would be noticed immediately, of course. But the gas stove, on the other hand, could be silently extinguished by the killer without anyone noticing.
I live around these parts myself, so I know what it's like. I can tell you, trying to sleep without the stove lit is pretty much suicide. You'd freeze to death in no time.
Mr. Garadev, the landlord, has a large fireplace in front of the residence on the top floor. In other words, it wasn't the landlord, but a fellow lodger whose life Mr. Shamsby was trying to end.
Outrageous!
I'm talking, of course, about the defendant. Mr. Natsume isn't the villain in this case. He's the victim this man was trying to murder.
Good gracious!
The accused is actually the aggrieved.
Interesting. However, the fundamental facts of the case remain unchanged. Namely, the accused is the aggressor here.
What? How could you still claim that?
Let us indulge your fancies for a moment and assume that there was indeed poison on the mouth of the gas pipe. The question that then arises, who put it there?
Who did put it there?
The only logical conclusion is that the person responsible was aware of this man's trickery with the gas supply and his intent to kill.
Yes, that would indeed seem logical.
If the assailant were unaware, how would he or she have been known to lace the end of the gas pipe with poison?
Now we must ask, how could anyone have known of Mr. Shamsby's murderous designs?
You mean to suggest...
Naturally, the sole possible answer to that question couldn't be more obvious. Only the man whose life was being threatened could possibly have known.
What?
In other words, the person who put the poison on the gas pipe in what was a clear retaliatory attack can only have been the accused, Mr. Soseki Natsume.
I hate it here. I hate it here.
I know. I hate this.
I hate it here.
Whatever Mr. William Shakespeare, Shamsby may or may not have contrived to do, he was nevertheless the victim of a potentially lethal poison attack. And the only person who could possibly have perpetrated that attack is the accused Mr. Natsume.
Uh-oh. He's bracing.
The defense counsel's theorizing has failed to avert suspicion from the accused. Far from it. In fact, now that a clear motive for the poisoning has been successfully established,
that suspicion is greater than ever.
Would you not agree, my Nipponese friend?
Ow. Oh, shit.
I fucking hate it here.
You too.
How did you manage to turn that around on me so rapidly?
Mr. Narahodo, you must respond. Otherwise, the members of the jury may very well change their leanings against us again. And this may be our last chance to gain the advantage.
What advantage?
Well, it would seem that somebody put poison on the gas pipe in Mr. Shamsby's room. So we must name the person now and absolve Mr. Natsume of guilt. I know just the one.
You mean, name the true culprit?
I know it might sound impossible, but if we fail to do that, I have no doubt that Mr. Natsume's fate will be sealed once and for all.
As it happens, one possible culprit does come to mind. The evidence, the poison, it's all pointing to a particular person.
The prosecution calls for the jury to consider their leanings again. I trust you'll make the correct choice this time, Mr. Foreman.
What? Oh, don't you worry. We know exactly...
There is one other person who I believe could have been involved in all of this. The true culprit of this crime.
The true culprit?
A term found only in second-rate novels featuring third-rate great detectives, my Nipponese friend. But why not? This farce has gone on for so long already, I see no reason to cut it short before its disappointing climax. Thank you. Tell us, my learned Nipponese friend, what is your latest theory? Who is the so-called true culprit of this crime?
Olive Green.
Wait, what?
Her.
Is that where I was
Olive
going
Green.
At all?
Her.
Are you serious?
Yes.
Okay, explain this to me because I'm lost.
But just her.
Are you? Give me reasoning.
I would, but we'd be here all day.
I cannot. I'm
her. Do it.
Can you not TLDR? Like, give me what?
Let's just say, it's for revenge against the killing of her husband.
She wait. Hold the phone. She knew?
Mm-hmm.
How?
The name of the person responsible for the person that afflicted Shamspear is, I believe, Miss Olive Green.
Miss Olive Green. I do feel as though I've heard that name in the recent past, Council, but I don't recall where.
Miss Olive Green, the woman from 6 days ago. The victim in the recent case of stabbing on Briar Road. An incident from which Mr. Natsume was arrested, I hasten to add.
Oh, of course, yes, Miss Green. She was left comatose for some 3 days, I believe. But I hear she regained consciousness 2 days ago.
And I hardly need remind the court that Mr. Shamspear's fight took place 3 days ago. Given that the woman was lying comatose in a hospital bed at the time, she appears to have a rather fine alibi. True, on the night that the incident occurred, Miss Green was in hospital unconscious. So on the face of it, it would seem that she couldn't possibly be responsible, but still... My colleagues and I visited Miss Green in hospital yesterday, and we found her to be in possession of a bottle of poison.
Crazy, she had poison?
And there is another fact that links Miss Green to this case as well. The defense requests that she be brought to the witness stand in order to explain the details to the court.
Tell me, Mr. Shamspear.
My lord, pray with thee be thy bidding.
Are you acquainted with Miss Green?
No, never heard of her.
Judging by the look on Mr. Shanspear's face, I think perhaps he generally doesn't know her. At least, not by name.
As the voice of Her Majesty's prosecution here, I adhere to my word. You will see my learned Nipponese friend's farce to its conclusion.
I appreciate that.
The prosecution requests a short recess, my lord, in order to subpoena the witness and bring her here.
Yes, Miss Olive Green.
Indeed, my lord. 1 hour should be sufficient.
Very well. I grant the request.
Excellent, I hope.
The defense has made a most extraordinary accusation, I must say. But at the present time, I feel the prosecution's argument remains largely uncontested. Accordingly, I'm afraid the defendant and his culpability remain the sole subject of this court's attention. Thank you, counsels. We reconvene in 1 hour. Court is adjourned.
I fucking hate it here.
Ooh, boy.
I fucking hate it. I hate every bit of what's going on right now because it hurts my brain.
I know.
And I can't comprehend how the evidence is pointing to her. Like,
Well, we gotta keep playing and find out.
I need a minute. Like, there is no way, even if, like, we didn't, like, there's no way. There's nothing. We would never have gotten that. How would we...
Well, she did possess poison, albeit it's medicinal poison. But
still, that's just like, that's still fucking...
And considering her husband stayed at the lodgings...
There's a motive, but the timeline doesn't add up.
It'll be explained. Please, guy, keep playing.
My brain hurts.
I know.
My brain fucking hurts. Oh, God. My brain hurts.
I know, dude. I know.
The minute you said that, I'm like, the fuck are you smoking? Ain't no way.
We gotta keep playing to find out.
I am at a loss for words.
I know.
Read.
23rd February, 11:32 a.m. The Old Bailey, Defendant's Ante Chamber.
Joyful, jubilant, jumping jacks!
Oh, Mr. Natsume. I'm so pleased for you.
Locum student, Mr. Narahoda Esquire, and not locum judicial assistant, Miss Mikotoba Esquires. Esquires, say that, hey. Now, finally, at long last, there can be proof. Proof that I'm innocent and proof that my tea is innocent.
Ah, good morning, my dear fellows.
Hi.
Ah, Herlock Sholmes. May you drink my tepid tea and forever sign it.
I thought the tea was innocent. Don't look at his left hand. Don't look at his left hand. Don't look at his left hand.
Oh, no, don't look at it. No,
don't look at it. Don't look at it. Don't look at his left hand. Don't look at his left hand. Do not look at it. No, chat, do not look at it. Do not look at it. Do not look at it.
Well, they wanted to look at it. Just move on. How was your soul? He came. How wonderful.
Please, save your derision. I know what you're all thinking. Good morning, he says, when it's very nearly time for luncheon. Your scorn is written clearly across your faces.
Nobody said or thought anything of the sort.
The truth is, I was determined that today would be the day. Sleep seduced me last night. I thought, tomorrow for once, I shall not oversleep. I'll rise early and be present in court to support my companions. That spirit of determination has a beauty all of its own, does it not?
Oh, yes.
This man can do no wrong in Suzato's eyes or yours.
And then I began to muse on the subject. Why do people oversleep? I queried. Why, time after time, do they make the same foolish blunder? And the answer came to me at once. It's so delightfully simple. People oversleep because they sleep.
Are you meaning to tell me you've been awake all night?
Genius. Fucking genius.
I fucking hate it here.
Well, is that not an astute insight into the matter?
Oh, yes.
You're all simps. Wait, did they? Forgot I said that.
Yeah, don't.
I had a moment.
It's okay.
A momentary lapse.
Upon which realization, I attempted an experiment. I didn't sleep a wink on. I knew it. I called it. And the results, by first light, I was exhausted and began to be assailed by fists of drowsiness. Shocking. And so, the conclusion of last night's experiment is this. A good night's sleep is quite simply essential.
Yes, I think most of us probably knew that already.
What others presuppose, I prove by experimentation. That, my dear fellows, the scientific method. Ah, yes, and one more thing. Do you remember this?
Oh!
Yes, of course. It's the poison that Miss Green was about to drink at the hospital yesterday.
Oh, you didn't manage to... It was a laborious task as the bottle was near empty, but such inconveniences do not hinder Sholmes. I managed to confirm that it contains strychnine.
What is happening? What the fuck is happening?
Uh-huh.
What is... I am gonna... Brain hurty. Brain hurty, no function. Why? What the fuck?
Keep playing.
I don't want to subject myself to this anymore. It hurts.
Do it.
The bone hurting, the brain hurting juice is so powerful.
Do it.
So I was right. Perhaps, though, of course, some circumstantial evidence doesn't prove Miss Green's guilt. I shall leave the bottle in your care now, but licking the inside of the neck is not recommended. I was expecting him to laugh after that.
Oh, God.
Could I have a word?
I can have a word.
Hey, Gregson!
Gregson, how good of you to come.
Forget it. Excuse me.
Wait a minute, Inspector.
I am... Don't wish to make a nuisance of myself.
From the look on your face, I'd say it's someone else who you think is making a nuisance of himself. My dear Inspector, please, speak freely. Pretend that I'm not here.
Believe me, if I could do that, life would be a whole lot simpler for me.
Oh, God.
I don't know why I find that hilarious.
Yo.
Do you have the results, Inspector, of the investigation of Mr. Shamsper's room?
Not yet. Shouldn't be long now, though. No, I'm here about something else. Dead convict, actually.
Oh, you mean the man from this newspaper article we discovered yesterday in Mr. Shamsper's room?
Oh, and by the name of his, Selden.
I went through the archives at the yard and dug out the fellow's file. There's something in there that, it caught my eye.
Oh, something that caught your eye? What, Inspector? What?
I've copied out the relevant parts for you, so you can read it for yourselves.
Thank you. I don't look at that right now, actually.
These documents.
Let's see. Investigative findings related to Selden. 18 counts of burglary, 6 counts of suspected murder. Died of natural causes whilst in prison. His final moments witnessed only by his cellmate. The estimated 1,000 pounds worth of loot he stole remains uncovered. Manchester's Strangeways Prison announced the death of convicted murderer and burglar Selden by natural causes in the early hours this morning. He had been suffering with fever since the end of October. Alerted by the shouts of his fellow cellmate, medical staff arrived to find him already dead before the capital punishment could be carried out.
Is his fortune involved? Was someone trying to steal the loot? Yep.
I thought you already knew that from the start.
Yep.
Why did you think Shanser wanted that specific room?
Yep, the loot.
You mean a loot? Well, I'm the Remy. Yeah, the papoose.
He want the monies.
Got some monies.
Include the details that were in the newspaper cutting we found in Mr. Shansbury's room. I'll rearrange everything in the court records so we don't have to duplicate information.
Why are you giving us a copy of this important file, though?
Well, you're the ones who turned up the clue in the first place, aren't you? I'm just making sure things get handled in the proper fashion.
Oh, Scotland Yard's workings are so wonderful.
Indeed, my dear fellows, and the inspector here is a shining diamond in its crown.
A shining diamond? A rough, maybe.
Look, I just don't want to be beholden to a lawyer, that's all.
Both of the defense and the defendant. Court proceedings are about to resume. Make your way into the courtroom at once.
That did not work good. That did not work how I expected it would.
Let go.
No, I tried to do that thing, you know how, like, if you push your head back enough, it looks like you have, double chins and shit? I was trying to do that to make a voice, and it sounded horrible.
Let's go.
Well, I shall leave you then. I'll be listening with interest from the public gallery. Not nodding off at all. Certainly not you. Fuck off.
Shut up.
Thank you, Mr. Shams. I'm rather tired of seeing Mr. Mustache in floods of tears personally, so the best of luck to you.
Welcome, student, Mr. Naruto Esquire.
Yes, Mr. Natsume.
It's time, isn't it?
Yes, this is it. Miss Olive Green and Mr. William Shamspear. This is going to be the final battle.
This fucking child is hurting my brain.
I won't really have saved Soseki-san until I've exposed the whole truth of everything that's been going on. But it's all coming to a head now. You can do it, Ryunosuke. You have to. Excuse me.
Do the thing.
I'm gonna do the thing.
Do the thing.
Wait, you want me to do the thing again? We're reconvening.
Yeah. Oh, never mind. 23rd February, 12:30 p.m., the Old Bailey courtroom. All right. Bring her out.
In the name of Her Majesty the Queen, I hereby declare this court to be in session again now. Before the recess, we heard a most startling accusation from the defense. Namely, that the victim of the case we heard here only a few days ago is the true perpetrator of this incident.
A reckless, rash, and prejudiced charge of wrongdoing, in my opinion, my lord. However, the prosecution has tried to extend every courtesy to this amateur newcomer from dubious eastern shores.
Thank you. Why am I thanking him? He's a piece of shit.
I know.
I hate this, how much this hurts my brain.
Let's just keep going. I gotta leave by 7.
Mm-hmm.
Okay. Yeah, I got you. Yeah. And...
Oh, yeah. There we go.
For that backhanded consideration.
Yep, it was a backhanded compliment.
Rather cold assessment from the Honorable British Prosecutor, I must say. You're not helping!
Oh, God.
Fuck right off, Judgy!
So, Lord Van Zeeks, is the new witness present and ready to take the stand?
Ready and waiting in the witness's antechamber, my lord.
Very well. Bailiff, bring the witnesses in. Bring.
Where'd that come from? That actually sounded pretty good.
Bring the witnesses in.
Sino, what's good, Sino?
When cats sound like parrots.
Witnesses, state your names and occupations for the court, please.
I am Shamspear, my liege. For mine occupation, I can say only that I be a tragic victim to be pitied.
Fuck off.
Currently unemployed, in other words.
No! I'm Olive Green. I'm a fledgling artist. Well, no. Not a fledgling, really. A hopeless failure who's too weak-spirited to admit she is the no talent, I suppose.
Can we not? Can we not? I hate it when people beat themselves up. I really do.
We're gonna be here for a long time.
Also currently unemployed, in other words. Wow.
My man too blunt for his own good.
Yep.
What's a coterie? A teary.
Mr. Shamspear.
My lord, I am thy humble servant.
No, you're not.
Fuck off.
I'm afraid that you are no longer merely the victim in this affair. The possibility has been raised that you are in fact the assailant, intent on taking the life of your fellow lodger. The part you have played in this whole business will be thoroughly scrutinized, I assure you.
I would for naught else, my lord.
Wait, did I hear a liar?
What?
Like, when he was spreading his efforts, I thought I heard a liar.
Oh, like a harp?
Yeah.
Maybe. I think so.
I wouldn't for naught else, my lord.
And Miss Green.
Yes?
You are aware of the reason you have been summoned to this courtroom today, I presume?
Yes, the officer did explain. He said I poisoned this ridiculous buffoon.
He's not wrong.
I'm sorry, that fucking caught me off guard. That was so good.
That was amazing.
That was so good.
A certain tune sends his love and support. I appreciate that.
Thank you.
And do you accept the charge, Miss Green?
I don't know anything about any poisoning. And I don't know anything about this man.
Come, lady. Die to live. verily, I know not thy prickly, pea-pigmented personage.
Very well. Let us proceed with the matter at hand. That being to ascertain whether or not Miss Green has any involvement in this affair.
It's all very strange. Very strange indeed. Why would you suspect me? I barely ever go to the East End anyway. It so happens that I passed by the neighborhood 6 days ago, that's all. And on the night that this man was poisoned, I was still in hospital, fighting for my life. Her eyes are shifting.
Yes, having been unfortunately caught up in the incident on the street outside the Garadab household. An incident that rendered you unconscious for some 3 days.
I was struck in the middle of my back by a knife, though not a fault of my own. And now I'm under suspicion? What other irrelevant things that might be suspected of? It's all very disturbing.
Your energies may be better spent worrying about random knife attacks, I feel, Miss Green.
At this point in time, all that appears to connect you with Mr. Shamsby's lodging is the Briar Road incident of 6 days ago. That's why we would like you to testify formally now about exactly what happened.
Oh, no. The incident 6 days ago. You mean you want me to relive that awful incident?
Unfortunately, yes. Please tell the court what happened that day. And of course, we will be interested to hear from you about your movements that day too, Mr. Shamsby. What happened 6 days ago has nothing to do with me being poisoned.
Let us proceed then. The witnesses will present their formal testimony to the court on the subject of the incident that took place on Briar Road the evening of the 17th of February.
Witness
testimony.
The evening of 17th February.
It was 6 days ago, about 5 p.m. I was walking along in the snow and I suddenly stabbed in the back. Coincidentally, it happened to be just outside the house where the man in the case has the lodgings.
I was at the tavern on the eve of which thou speakest, for I had bespoke my supper.
It was the first time I had been in the area. I had a little matter of tender to have, that's all. Anyway, I was admitted straight to the hospital, so I knew nothing about all this business.
Yes. Second incident inside a week of what I believe to be aptly described as the haunted lodgings. One can only presume this is a most unfortunate coincidence.
Meanwhile, you say you are not in your room, Mr. Shamspear? It was the following morn when I did awaken that I learned of the dire event. Mary, what a commotion did the office of the law make on the floor above mine? And Soseki-san was arrested on suspicion of attempted murder. As suspected, there is nothing connecting these two witnesses but happenstance. It's true, it does seem as though they're unrelated at first glance. But I'm not so sure. There's something lurking in the shadows here, and I feel certain of it. And this is my one and only chance to expose it.
Counsel, you may now cross-examine these two witnesses if you wish.
Yes, my lord. Swing.
Cross-examination.
The evening of 17th February.
Press on 4.
Oops.
Hold it. What little matter, Miss Green? Please elaborate.
It was nothing really. It's not worth mentioning.
If you remember, you mentioned it to us yesterday at the hospital.
Ah.
It was related to the card you were holding. Miss Green! What was that? She clearly just hid something behind her back. From memory, I believe the card contained a note that read, I have information regarding the death of Duncan Ross.
What does that matter? This has nothing to do with the Duncan...
Excuse you, sir.
Mr. Shamsby, do you have something to share with the court?
To be or not to be, that is the question. Ah, pray forgive me. The great Bardsworth springeth from within me with ne'er a thought.
Don't tell me it's because you're possessed by Shakespeare's spirit, right?
Hearing Miss Green's words a moment ago seemed to make you think of something. Something of relevance, perhaps?
Well, nay, nay, sire, 'twas nothing at all.
Presumably you know the name, though, Mr. Duncan Ross, I mean. After all, you were both lodgers in the same house.
I would it were so, but sadly, nay. Lodging be a lonely occupation, sire. My lodging fellows will be rarely known to me.
So you haven't heard of him, even though he passed away in the room just one floor above yours?
Miss Green.
Me, my lord. Have I done something wrong?
The card that was mentioned before, containing the note. Do you have it upon your person?
I do, yes. But I do not need any more. In fact, I should throw it away. It's torn off!
Yeah.
Before you dispose of it, the court will take it as evidence, please.
And we have the other piece.
Yeah.
Yeah, examine it. We got to examine to present.
Of course, that's what links Mr. Shamspear and Miss Green.
We can't present it now. We just got to examine.
Do you remember where we found this torn off piece of envelope?
Yes, of course. It was in Mr. Shamspear's room.
For some reason, it suddenly started to bother me. The way it's been ripped, I feel sure I've seen the same pattern somewhere else.
Ah, I wonder if it could be this you're thinking of. The envelope which Miss Green's card came.
Yes, that's it. Try putting them together now and let's see.
And bing.
Bing bong bing.
They go together perfectly. This torn off envelope clearly belongs to the Miss card.
What was it torn with?
That's weird. Anyway, now go to statement 3. Shamspear's statement.
Oops, wrong button.
So, let's resume with the dialogue.
Of course, that's what links Mr. Shamspear and Miss Green. It's Duncan Ross.
Oh, continue your testimony, please, Miss Green.
All right, Shamspear, we need to talk.
I will present. Oh, hold it?
Yeah, hold it.
Hold it! A tavern, you say? Which one?
Was the Slug and Salad where I did tarry. There's a jewel in the East End.
And a little unexpected, I feel. What do you mean, Lord Van Zeeks?
The Slug and Salad offers unusually fine dining for the locality, at least. Not an establishment you'd expect to be patronized by a man with not even a crumb of bread in his room.
Burn!
Damn! Oh, it's true. The menu lists premium crusts of bread and glasses of water in different levels of cloudiness.
I would have expected Grubb's Grubbery in the local vicinity to be more appropriate for your means. Watery soup and mushy peas, or rather, soupy water and pea-like mush.
Oh, God.
My man is just burying him at this point.
I know.
Kayfabe,
all equally appetizing.
I just wanted to try some water in a different pub for once. What's wrong with that?
What different can water really be?
You'd be surprised, depending on where you get your water in this country.
Or perhaps there's more plausible explanation. A specific reason why he had to go to that particular establishment. Miss Green's card.
Agreed. The fact that on that day of all days he dined at a place he wouldn't normally, it does stand out. Mr. Shamspear's own actions of the day of the incident 6 days ago were slightly suspicious. I wonder if we have some evidence that can explain those actions.
Yes, present evidence.
Mr. Shamspear. Yes, sire. On the day in question, is it not the case that you visited the Slug and Salad, a place you don't normally patronize? For a very particular reason?
I don't know what you're talking about. Pray, if thou hast some purpose, speak.
Very well. I will present the court with evidence. Evidence that explains why you had to be at the Slug and Salad that day, namely the card.
Miss Green's card.
Take that!
I believe this card reveals the answer.
Good lord, Miss Green's card, you mean?
That's right, my lord. It reads, I have information regarding the death of Duncan Ross. Come to the Slug and Salad on Briar Road at 5 p.m. on the 17th. Don't tell anyone else about this letter or the meeting. It is a matter of utmost importance. Mr. Shamspere, your actions on the afternoon of Miss Green's stabbing are exactly as described in this note. Personally, I find it hard to believe that's a coincidence. Don't you, Mr. Shamspere? Well...
Excuse me, can I say something?
Yes, Miss Green.
That card was delivered to me. It doesn't have anything to do with this odd man, does it?
Well, you'd think so, yes, but it's hard to believe it's merely...
My lord, may I?
May you what, Miss Green?
I'd like to make something very clear about the card.
Very well, then. You may amend your testimony to include details about the peculiar note.
This note was delivered to me at my address. It's got nothing to do with the odd man next to me here. Oh, really? Then what about the other end of the envelope?
The day before the incident, exactly 1 week ago now, this note was delivered to your address. And upon carrying out the instructions of the note, you found yourself in hospital.
Yes, I did. It's terrible. Everything that has happened to me.
Yes, it is terrible. If it's all true, that... What the fuck? What is happening?
What do you mean?
Miss Green, have a look at this, please. It's the torn off end of an envelope.
Oh, is it?
And it so happens that it fits together perfectly with the envelope of the note you received.
Where did you find that?
In Mr. Shamspear's room. In my room? Mr. Shamspear, do you perhaps remember this note from somewhere? Well, your actions after afternoon follow the instructions in the note to the letter. Come to the Slug and Salad on Briar Road at 5 p.m. on the 17th. And so, that's exactly where you went. Let me ask you again, Mr. Shamspere. You already knew about this note, didn't you? And you, Miss Green.
What do I do?
As this torn off end of the envelope proves, the note was originally in Mr. Shamspere's room. So how is it that it came to be in your possession?
I don't have the first idea. I'm just a fledgling artist, after all.
There is only one explanation. You broke into Mr. Shamsu's room and stole it. You did what? Sorry, thou hast what? You broke, thou were in my room? What on earth do you want with me? Oh my god, is Shamsu gonna be the fucking sympathetic one? What is happening?
Keep going!
It would seem that both witnesses need to testify again.
Miss Green. Okay.
Yes?
Whilst you have the court's sympathy, I'm sure, for the suffering you have endured in recent events, anyone found to be giving false testimony in court of law will be duly punished. Please bear that in mind. The Reaper speaketh.
Oh, yes. I know.
Very well, then. Witnesses, you will give formal testimony again now. On the subject of this curious anomaly regarding the note Miss Green claims to have received.
Witness testimony.
This shit just keeps getting weirder and weirder.
The anomaly of the note. I do remember now. It was a week ago, peradventure, that note was delivered unto me. On the day writ therein, I did tarry a long hour at the Slug and Salad, yet nobody came.
Thereafter, on the evening I shared the company of the Japanese fellow, I did see the note had vanished.
I don't know what you mean. You think I snuck into this man's room, do you? Why would I? I can point out the villain here, and as for that torn-off piece of that envelope, I don't know anything about it.
Some feigning ignorance here.
You now claim to have received this letter, do you, Mr. Shamspear? Faith is so, my lord. And I would swear to have set it upon the table in my humble lodgings, yet it is clear to me now that since I returned from the tavern that night, I have not laid eyes upon it.
Well, that being the case, young lady, it would appear that your testimony was...
A lie? Is that what you think? How unfair do you think I'm the one lying?
I beg your pardon?
I'm just a fledgling artist, as I said, and fledgling artists don't lie.
Bullshit!
You lied just now, sweetie. We have evidence. You lied just now. That note was delivered to me at my address. Besides, we all know who the liar around here is.
If that's true, Miss Green, how do you explain the facts? Part of the envelope was, without question, found in Mr. Shamspear's room.
I don't see why I should explain.
Sorry?
I'm a fledgling artist. My job here is to say what happened, that's all. It's your job to get the explanations and the proofs. You, the fledgling lawyer.
The fledgling will do his best.
This that bullshit. I hate when they get snippy like that.
I know.
Evidently, my learned friend's cross-examination is our only hope of learning the truth.
Well, counsel.
I'm ready, my lord.
Very well, then. The defense will now proceed with the cross-examination of the witnesses.
Miss Green clearly did break into Mr. Shansbury's room. There can be no question of that. And that's how she acquired the note.
Yes, two facts that are starting to lead me to a possible explanation for all of this. And it's not a pretty one.
No matter what it is, we're all going to leave here mind-fucked.
Cross-examination.
The anomaly of the note.
Present the bottle of poison on statement 4. Bottle of poison.
Bottle of poison.
Boom!
Yesterday at the hospital, we saw you with this bottle. And though the contents spilt during the course of our meeting, a small quantity remained. According to the defense's independent analysis, the liquid that was still in the bottle was identified as strychnine.
What? Strychnine? The very same poison that afflicted Mr. Shamspear.
Miss Green, you broke into this man's lodgings for one reason and one reason alone. To cover the end of the pipe that feeds the gas lamp of Mr. Shamspear's room with poison.
Can this be?
You broke into my room? You broke into my room to... It may seem incredible to the court, but from the remaining clues, there is only one logical conclusion that we can reach. The person who attempted to take Mr. Shamspear's life with poison was you, Miss Olive Green.
Oh dear, me.
I love freakouts.
I know.
I'm not gonna lie, man.
Order! Counsel, are you seriously suggesting this woman put poison on the end of the gas pipe with intent to kill?
Yes, my lord. There's no other way to explain the facts.
But if Miss Green did indeed set this odious trap 6 days ago, the victim had put his mouth to the pipe that very evening as expected, the attempted murder would have happened 6 days ago, surely.
Well, that's a very good point. Perhaps not,
well,
my lord.
Who's to say the poison didn't have
your pardon?
A certain potency?
There was a significant police presence in the area that evening on the account of the incident of Briar Road. Local residents were being interviewed throughout the night as part of the ongoing inquiry. A circumspect criminal would likely have chosen not to carry out any wrongdoing at that time. Lord Antiques?
Then, of course, the following morning, there was more activity at Mr. Chansper's address.
More activity? Yes.
You mean his fellow lodger, Mr. Natsume, being arrested on suspicion of murder?
That's right. And as a defense, he has already proposed. Mr. Shamsper was meddling with the gas pipe and for the very sinister reason himself. To cause the gas stove in Mr. Natsume's room to go out, thereby asphyxiating the occupant.
But once Mr. Natsume had been arrested, his room was under constant surveillance by the police. In the circumstances, Mr. Shamsper had no reason to blow air into the gas pipe. His intended victim being in a prison cell. With the need to tamper with the gas removed, the poison on the pipe lay dormant.
And then, 3 days ago, 3 days ago now, the situation changed again.
Right. Mr. Natsume's trial, which took place here at the Old Bailey, came to an end.
A trial in which the man stood accused of stabbing Miss Green in the back, but was duly acquitted.
That resulted in Mr. Natsume returning to his lodgings for the first time in 2 days. And that very night, his gas stove mysteriously went out, and Mr. Shamsper was mysteriously poisoned. In conclusion, the poison that was present on the mouth of the gas pipe had been put there in the victim's room some 4 days earlier.
Not Mary!
With that new understanding, it becomes clear that this letter was all part of the plan.
What plan?
The court will recall that the note gave instructions to visit the slug and salad at 5 o'clock, and that the recipient should tell nobody else. The reason for those instructions are now clear. To ensure that the lodger would not be at home at the slated time.
Make sure I wasn't home?
Exactly. While you were out, Miss Green could safely slip into your room, knowing that she wouldn't be disturbed.
You mean to say, that letter
was written by Miss Green, yes. And in order to cover her tracks, she took it away with her when she left. Just after she smeared poison over the mouth of the gas pipe in your room.
Order! Order! What do you have to say for yourself, witness?
Oh, shit.
Oh, snap.
Hold on 1 second. Hold on. 1 second. This shit getting fucking real.
Yep.
Oh, man. This trial has been something else. And I've sat through some Phoenix Wright trials that have equally insanity in my day. But this just fucking takes the cake.
Let's keep going.
Just who are you? Why did you try to kill me?
Miss Green's motive should be obvious. It's all tied up with someone whose name we've heard several times already during the course of this trial. So, that's what's behind all this.
You'll share your apparent understanding with the court, please, counsel. Which person is behind this one?
Do we have to say it? Do we have to fucking
Duncan
say
Ross.
It?
Duncan Ross.
That's right. Before the defendant, Mr. Natsume, took up residence in the lodgings of Mr. Garadeb's, somebody else was renting the room. Mr. Duncan Ross.
I knew I'd heard the name somewhere else. It was all over the papers a month ago, when the man died in strange circumstances at the haunted lodgings. That does ring a vague... Oh, of course, yes. I remember now. The young man they claimed was strangled by the convict's curse or some such.
Sadly, my lord... It wasn't a curse of any kind, nor was it an accident. The man died as a result of Mr. Shamsper blowing into the gas pipe and causing gas to leak into the room. It was murder, plain and simple.
Okay, no sympathy for you. Fuck you.
Yep. All right. Well, what do you know? The world. So unfair. Curses. Curious deaths. That's all people care about. If it's an interesting story they want to know, it doesn't cross their minds that real people are involved. And once they're bored, just 1 month later, once the story lost its appeal, everyone's forgotten him.
You mean you... Duncan was...
Mr. Ross was Miss Green's fiancé.
Fiancé?
You may not have known until now who Miss Green really is, Mr. Shamspere. But she's known exactly who you are all along. Because you're her sworn enemy. The murderer who took the life of the man she was to marry.
Marry?
Miss Green, is it not the case that in order to exact revenge on Mr. Shamspere, you smeared poison over the end of the gas pipe?
She couldn't even look at us.
This is all quite extraordinary. Am I correct in my understanding that you now accuse both parties' counsel, each on different counts of murder?
Yes, my lord, that's correct.
Objection. Inhaling so deeply, it appears that my fledgling learned friend has taken in a lungful of dubious gas that's causing his judgment to be clouded.
What?
Why would Mr. Shamspere have wanted to kill these lodges, as you say? You have completely failed to provide a motive to substantiate your accusation against the man.
Yes, yes! That's right, Mr. Reaper, my liege. I have been slighted. His lies, all lies. I deny every utterance.
And you ought to forgive me, Mr. Nadahodo, sir. But I don't intend to admit anything either.
Miss Green.
I am sure you'll think I'm being very rude, but I'm not going to be sent to the gallows for the likes of these scoundrels.
But you broke into the man's room. If you didn't do it to smear poison in the pipe, what was your reason?
I thought I had to look around, that's all.
Sorry.
You're right, I suspected him. So I thought perhaps I might find some evidence or something in this room. Evidence that it was him who took Duncan's life.
Oh, vileness, oh, villainy, oh, tyranny, oh, rotundity of woman! But in any case, whether I leave my room, I do turn the key in the lock.
That whole place is falling apart. The locks and the doors are no different. Duncan showed me once how to unlock the door with some chips and piece of wire. What's that around your neck?
Oh, awfulness! Oh, artfulness! Oh, tyranny! Oh, profanity of woman!
We will consider your trespassing on some future occasion. But for now, tell the court what you found. What evidence your search revealed?
Well, I spotted the note that I'd sent him lying on the floor. When I went to pick it up, I noticed something. One of the floorboards was loose, and underneath it, I discovered a secret hiding place.
Yes, we also discovered that hiding place.
Inside, we found a newspaper cutting, a photograph, and an empty tin box. Ah, yes. Well, the thing is, when I found it, the box wasn't empty.
You bitch.
Oh, you motherfucker.
What? There was something in it?
Yes. This rather nice key.
Ah!
Oh, shit.
What? What are you doing with that? What the?
Every ounce of color has drained from his face.
Give it here. Give it to me now. It's mine. I inherited it.
What was that, witness? What did you say? You inherited it.
What's all this about? He inherited that key?
It was obviously important to you, since you'd gone to such lengths to hide it, so I took it. I don't know what it's for, but you took something precious from me, so I took something precious from you. Fucking hell! So what if it means you can't just open something now? I don't care.
Give it back this minute! Give it to me!
Oh, calm yourself, witness. I thought it was order.
So Mr. Shamspere's tried in one case, succeeded to take a life of two lodges now. Yes, his motive for doing so is the key to everything that's happened. It's true that there appears to be no motive to support the accusation against Mr. Shamspere at first. But considering everything we know now, I think there is actually something that could explain it.
What?
We need to recall every piece of evidence at our disposal. Everything we've seen and heard. Because I'm sure that I just caught a glimpse of the link that runs through all of these events.
In that case, counsel, I must demand that you present evidence to the court in support of your claim. What is it that you say you can explain the motivation for Mr. Shamspear's alleged crime?
The Capital Offenders File!
That's an official police report, is it not? The Selden file. How did you get hold of that?
Selden! The now sadly deceased Mr. Ross and the defendant Mr. Natsume have only one thing linking them. The fact that they had lodgings in the same room.
Well, yes, we know this, certainly.
A room that was formerly occupied by Selden, until, that is, he was arrested by Scotland Yard for his involvement in multiple burglaries.
I see.
And it so happens that the convict Selden left behind one very substantial mystery when he died. Some £1,000 worth of loot that he stole, which as yet remains to be found.
Yes, of course. It's coming back to me now. It's written in this file here.
£1,000 lost en route to hell. That was how the papers summed it up. And it seems that one particular fellow inmate was with the convict in his final moments. It's not hard to imagine Selden entrusting that inmate with his most closely guarded secret, the location of the stolen loot, and perhaps a key to unlock whatever container the valuables were in.
You mean like this key is...
Mr. Shamspear, it was you, wasn't it? You were at the Capital Offender's side when he died, were you not?
What are you talking about? It's a false charge, I tell you. A false charge.
The name of the inmate who was with Selden at his death isn't noted in this file. But a simple telegram to the prison where he died would quickly tell us how false the charge really is.
But even if it's true, why would the man be so intent on killing every subsequent occupant of the convict's lodgings?
There's only one explanation for that, my lord. It was in that very room that Selden hid his loot! So, it all comes out. Yes, and having established that, all of Mr. Shamspear's subsequent actions start to make perfect sense. When he was let out of prison following Selden's death, he made immediately for Mr. Garadeb's lodgings in the hope of renting Selden's old room. However, the retired army man was unable to offer him the accommodation of his choice. Because Selden's old room had already been let to somebody else, Mr. Duncan Ross. Which is why Mr. Shamspear subsequently devised his gas-based plot to kill the occupant of the room. And when he was successful, he presumably intended to inquire about switching to the newly vacant room. However, a certain jittery someone had beaten him to it.
Mr. Suzuki Natsume, the defendant of this case, no less.
So you decided to use the ploy with the gas again, didn't you, Mr. Shamspear? This time to oust Mr. Natsume. All for one simple and avaricious reason. To get your hands on the £1,000 of loot left behind by the dead convict.
You...
Death.
Dead.
You are dead. Not a big surprise. Looks like I'm gonna snuff it before they get to stretch me neck. Listen, I want you...
Listen, I want you to have me loot. Anything to stop the golfers getting their mittens on it? Is it in the room where I was lodging when they got me? Yeah, this is the key to it. Take it. Always stay one step ahead, mate. See you in hell, I guess. Shamspear.
Fuck!
Mine. What did he just say? It's mine. That loot is mine.
Uh-oh.
Oh, fuck! Mr. Shamspear? It's all lies. I don't accept any of it. Why should I? After all, you don't have a shred of evidence. You can't prove I killed that fellow. Also, I'm the victim here, remember? Isn't that right, ladies and gentlemen?
I don't admit to it, there's nothing you can do. You can't arrest me. For the time being, anyway. Verily, you can't arrest the victim, can you? Isn't that right, ladies and gentlemen? I'm so close. I just need a few more hours. I swore to myself that I'd get my hands on it. And I can almost taste it now. Do you really think I'd just give up?
There's no question in my mind now. The man is guilty through and through.
But he seems so utterly intoxicated by the idea of that loot. I'm afraid that however hard you press him, he'll never admit to what he's done, Mr. Nadahodo.
There is a way.
Pardon?
There's one way I can finish him.
Oh!
He's already committed the most heinous crimes to get his hands on that loot. Which means all we need to do is find it first. A fine plan. Were it not for the fact that the police thoroughly searched the room following the death of Mr. Ross. If it's there at all, it must be very well hidden indeed.
Without conclusive evidence, I certainly cannot rule.
If only there was some way we could find the convict's loot quickly.
This is the final piece in this complex puzzle. But I think we might have it in our possession already. Or rather, I think we may well have something that can help us find where that loot is hidden. My lord.
Yes, Castle.
The defense would like to make a proposal about how to find the late convict's hidden loot. I believe you are already in possession of something that could give us a clue as to its whereabouts. It's our last chance. It has to be worth a gamble. Besides, we've used the same technique once already, and it definitely paid off then.
Very well then, Counsel. Let the court hear your idea. What do you propose we can use in order to locate the hiding place of the deceased convict's hall?
The handprints on the wall.
Take that! If I'm not mistaken, those are Mr. Shamsby's handprints on the wall of his lodgings.
That's right, my lord. Exposed as a result of the defense independent investigation of the scene.
Based on the wonderful new discovery in the field of forensic science by the great detective Mr. Sholmes.
A great detective? Is that some kind of joke? Do you really think I'm going to be daunted by a man with such a ridiculous title? I should think the great Pod ought to recognize such a title when he hears one, Mr. Shamspear. Perhaps we should compete for the honor of the most ridiculous title?
Ah, 'tis Herlock Sholmes himself!
What are you doing here, great detective? Your usual haunts are the filthy back streets of the capital, are they not?
Ah, Mr. Reaper, it's been too long. I see your complexion has worsened since last we met. Mr. Sholmes, he does know Lord Van Seek's then. Well, enough to say something like that in any case.
Mr. Sholmes, though you may be heralded as a great detective by the population at large, that does not give you the right to come and go in my courtroom as you see fit.
If I may, my lord. Mr. Sholmes' newly developed scientific method has helped us to uncover the vital clues in this case already.
Clues, you say?
I call them skin prints, my lord. My method identifies every location touched by an individual under scrutiny. It's the method by which we're able to ascertain this gentleman's gas pipe activities. You need only a small sample of something the individual has previously touched to make an indicator solution. In your case, sir, I used the teacup you had been holding. Elementary. So now, Mr. Nadahodo. Yes. What am I to use as a sample to make the indicator solution this time? Thank you for your offering to help, Mr. Shelms. When the convict was arrested, he was living in what is now Soseki-san's room. We need a sample to help locate Selden's loot that is hidden in his old room. What form will the sample take?
Present a person.
Olive Green?
Yep. Present Olive
Green. We will need
Green.
Something of Selden's in order to create the indicator solution to find his loot. And something the convict owned happens to be in the possession of somebody listed in the court record.
Oh my word, Mr. Nadahodo. Your powers of reasoning appear to be on the up.
So, which particular person do you have in mind? From whom can we obtain a possession of the late convict Selden to create the indicator solution?
Olive Green.
Miss Green.
Oh, me? What do you want with me?
The key around your neck, if you please.
Sorry?
That key belonged to Selden. There will be remnants of secretions from the man's skin on its surface that we can use.
Very true.
That is the sample we need. Using it, we can create the indicator solution required for Mr. Shum's skin print seeker and find out exactly what Selden touched in the room that he used to rent.
Ah, Mr. Shamspear, that's one great to another, I assure you. If the late convict's hall is hidden somewhere in his former lodgings, I shall uncover into no more than 30 minutes. So, Mr. Shamspear, the truth is well within our grasp now, and as such, you will never get your hands on Selden's stolen wealth.
Uh-oh. In that case, I'll gladly let Mr. Sholmes have this key.
No! Give the key to me! The detective shan't have it!
It's over, Mr. Shamspear.
No! No!
You're out of options now. There's only one thing left for you to do. Admit your guilt!
Whoa. Oh, Shamplespear. Despair. Be thy name.
That's a breakdown.
Fucking, I don't even know what the fuck happened there. Like, where'd the confetti fucking come from?
Oh.
I never intended to kill the man. I just wanted to drive him out of the room. That's all. So you'd have time to find the convict's hall of stolen goods. Yet, if you killed the young man, you still didn't move into the room. I asked the landlord, of course. I pleaded with him, but he refused. Why? I was 3 months behind with the rent, for one thing. Mr. Gerardev really has had a lot to put up with. But for one thing. And he had the gas repair work done immediately afterwards, putting the room out of action for a while. And then, this Japanese man swooped in at just the right moment to sign the new lease.
Poor Mr. Natsume. What unfortunate timing.
And 5 days ago, after the incident on Briar Road, when the Japanese fellow got himself arrested, I thought I'd finally have my chance, but it wasn't to be. No, the scene was sealed off and guarded by the police night and day.
And if I remember rightly, Mr. Strom spent the whole day in there reading books.
I couldn't even enter the room, let alone search for the loot. Which is why, on the day Mr. Natsume was acquitted and returned to his room, you once again tried your trick of blowing air into the gas pipe that feeds the stove in his room. Unbeknownst to you, however, that action would lead you into a deadly trap.
William Shamspear, how does it go? To be or not to be? That is the question.
From Shakespeare's Hamlet, Act 3, Scene 1.
Well, let me tell you, in your case, it's not to be. That is the answer. You deserve to die for what you've done. At first, I really did think it was just a terrible accident. I'll never forget our conversation the night before Duncan died. The gas supply in my new lodgings are a complete disaster, you know. Oh, it's you.
Gas supply in my new lodgings are a complete disaster, you know, Olive.
The gas supply?
Yes. The stove always seems to go out in the middle of the night for some reason.
That's no joke.
They say it's the convict's curse.
Oh, Duncan, please, don't stay there. I don't care how cheap it is.
All right, then. If it's that important to you, I'll start looking for a new place.
There are spare rooms in my house. Why don't you leave that horrible room tonight?
No, I'd better not. We said we'd wait until we graduated before we told our parents, remember?
But that was the last time we ever spoke. That very night, he fell victim to the gas. If only I knew it was going to happen, I'd have insisted he left that horrible room that instant. But instead, all I've been left with was a bit of regret. I stopped going to school. But something kept drawing me back to the house on Briar Road. I saw a stopped eastern-looking man with a mustache coming out of the house one day when I was there. He walked up to the Grub's Grubbery for some food, so I followed him. I sat myself down next to him. He had some watery-looking soup and started to pick a quarrel with the publisher.
The place is cursed, I tell you. Cursed! The ghost of that convict who used to live there. He's trying to suffocate me.
I wake up in the middle of the night, freezing to death because the stone has gone out. The room is full of gas and I can hardly breathe. But the pipes have been checked. No problem there. It's like I'm the problem. That's what they're thinking.
But how could that be? Duncan was gone, and now this man had almost suffered the same fate. Could it really be a curse? Then I remembered. A rumor I'd heard about how the gas companies go around investigating the gas installations.
A rumor? Ah, you mean...
Yes. Everybody's heard the stories, it seems, about how they go around checking the pipes.
How anything connected to the gas can be extinguished by blowing air into the pipework.
That's when it started. A little flicker of doubt in the back of my mind that just wouldn't go away. Was it really an accident, though? Once I had the idea, it wouldn't leave me alone. It plagued me day and night. So I bought this at the back of the black markets in the East End.
A black market?
I never been. I just heard people talk about them, and you really can buy anything you can think of there. In some ways, being able to get my hands on this so easily made me even more determined. I had to find out one way or another. Was Duncan's death an accident, or was it murder?
And your chosen method for establishing the truth was simple, but highly effective. Smear poison on the gas pipe you suspected the man of tampering with, and wait. If Mr. Shamspear was innocent, nothing would come of what you'd done. But if he was guilty, he would pay for his crimes dearly.
I found out the name of the man I suspected, William Shamspear. And then I wrote them this little note. I have information regarding the death of Duncan Ross. Come to the Slug and Salad on Briar Road at 5 p.m. on the 17th. Don't tell anybody else about this letter or the meeting. It is a matter of utmost importance. If he'd done it, I knew that I would worry him enough so he'd be sure to go. So I waited to see if it worked.
And of course, Mr. Shamspear followed the instructions to the letter.
I worked out where the gas pipe was straight away. So I smeared a good amount of poison I brought all around the mouth of that pipe. All the time praying that the devil's work wouldn't be done, and that it was all just some wild fantasy. Actually, no. All the time praying that the devil's work would be done, and that the culprit would get what he just deserves.
This went places.
Yep.
Don't, please, no crying. Do not cry, Sato.
Fucking hell.
Ay, ay, ay. 3 days ago, when you first stood in the dock before me, this whole affair seemed relatively straightforward.
Yes, my lord.
I certainly never imagined the depths of depravity that we should subsequently find lurking behind the scenes.
It has been a long road, my Nipponese friend.
Oh, yes.
And one I can certainly didn't envision walking with you.
Nevertheless, together we have reached the light at the end of the tunnel, as it were. Miss Green.
Yes, my lord?
You will henceforth be stripped of your freedom as punishment for the attempted murder of Mr. William Shamspear.
Yes, I know.
And you, Mr. Shamspear, you'll be tried for the murder of Mr. Duncan Ross in cold blood and the subsequent attempted murder of Mr. Soseki Natsume here present.
Mr. Nadahodo?
Yes.
Yesterday, at the hospital, when you and your friends stopped me from...
From ending your life by drinking what was left in the poison bottle?
I wasn't myself. I can't even really remember what was going through my mind. To be or not to be, I suppose.
Wow.
That's a question that's so hard to answer, it seems.
That was deep.
But, yeah.
Fuck.
Well, personally, I'm glad of your being here, Miss Green.
Oh.
And I'd like to believe that it's a blessing Mr. Shamspear didn't die when he ingested the poison. For your sake, at the very least.
Because of you, I chose life, not death. And now you've made the truth come out at last. Really, I can't thank you enough. Oh, Miss Green.
Mr. Suzuki Natsume.
My lord.
The court declares that you are exonerated from all blame in this matter. Accordingly, I would call upon the ladies and gentlemen of the jury to present a verdict of not guilty. We are in full agreement, my lord. In that case, I hereby declare the defendant...
not guilty! Fire the fireworks!
Finally!
Rider kick.
Oh, we did it!
Pew, 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 pew. Wayne's World! Wayne's World! Party time! Excellent!
Court is adjourned.
We did it!
Oh my god. Thank you for the ride of punch.
We did it!
Hit me.
23rd February, 3:24 p.m. The Old Bailey Defendant's Antechamber.
Oh, yes. Yes, at last. Divine justice duly done.
Divine justice? My dear fellow, if there were any divine justice in this world, you would shave that mustache.
No, this has nothing to do with my mustache.
Fucking gremlin.
Some say the luxuriant mustache is a sign of physical prowess, Mr. Sholmes.
Look, I'm still a Mr. Naruto Esquire. Once again, you've saved me from doom.
I'm very happy to have been able to help Mr. Natsume. Congratulations on your acquittal. You're second in almost as many days.
I was first acquainted with and gained affection for English literature whilst in our great homeland empire. And then, by a twist of fate, I was brought to the land that bore the fruit of that literature. Only the city of bricks and mortar became my prison. Try as I might, I never found my feet here. In the end, I confined myself to my room and lived life through friendly old books.
You've had such a difficult time, haven't you?
But a week ago now,
I dragged you out of that dark contingent room of yours, did I not?
You did, you did. I've seen more of life in this week than in all my years to date. And for the first time, I feel I've begun to see the true face of the English that's so far been hiding from me behind the wall of fog.
My dear fellow, there is nothing special about the true face of the English, as you put it. Wheresoever one goes in the world, humans are human. There are few genuine differences.
Yes, I think you're right. I finally started to see that, and I've come to understand something. I've worked out why I was attracted to English literature in the first place. It made me see that whatever our nationality, we humans all have the same hopes and fears. We're all just doing our best to live.
That's deep.
Yeah.
It's hella deep.
Well said. I've come to feel the same way.
I've made a decision too. I'm going to cut short my study tour here and return to Japan.
What?
Just when we became friends here in England, what a terrible shame.
No crying. No crying, please. No crying.
Don't cry.
Oh, I know. That does tug at my sting heart. Heartstrings, it really does. But I decided I'd like to take everything I've learned here in Britain and write something of my own. A novel of sorts, I suppose. Wait.
Huh?
What are you implying?
Oh my, so you'll be creating your own literature, Mr. Natsume? How wonderful.
Did we ever figure out what the pun of his name was?
Let's see.
Soseki Natsume.
He's the... Oh my gosh!
What?
He's named after the famous Japanese novelist.
Hmm?
So, jeez. It is a coincidence.
There's some deep cuts in this bitch.
Soseki Natsume is a real Japanese novelist. He's of the same name.
Oh, well, no, I mean, I wouldn't presume to call it literature.
Why not? When that is precisely the definition, Mr. Mustache.
I suppose you're right, yes. It will, in a way, be literature. But as of now, all I know is that I'd like to try my hand at writing. I have no delusions of grandeur.
I, for one, would love to read your work.
Well, all things considered, it may be for the best. After all, you have once again emerged victorious. From a battle with the Reaper.
Ah, that's very true.
And there is no salvation for a person in the dock when the Reaper is the prosecutor.
The desire to return post-haste to the perceived safety of your homeland is one I quite understand.
My goodness, yes. Faced with such terrifying prospect. Nobody would consider that cowardly, I'm quite sure.
Charlie Chaplin.
But that's not why I'm leaving. I mean it. Objection.
And that was the case that we found ourselves embroiled in 6 months ago now. So Seki-san did indeed return to Japan and submitted a report about both cases to the government. It was on reading that report that Professor Mikotoba was prompted to visit the scholar. Barely any time later, Susato-san was given the news that she must return to Japan as well. On the back of a telegram stating falsely that her father had fallen gravely ill. The only possible explanation that comes to mind is what happened after the trial, on the following day. The day that we uncovered the loot hidden by the now-deceased convict in his former lodgings.
February 24th, 10:13 a.m. Mr. Natsume's room. Oh, well done, Mr. Sholmes. How simply marvelous of you to uncover the secret hiding place in just one day.
Wasn't it supposed to take 30 minutes? As I believe I told you, my dear fellows, skin prints are extremely useful in such situations. Wouldn't you agree, Gregson? This man has a deep-seated hatred.
I know.
Gregson's been happily munching in the green room this whole time, you know, Hurley.
Best girl! Everybody!
Hey, best girl! Best Bean!
Best Bean! Best Bean! Everyone spam the freaking iris emote! Best Bean is here!
It's Best Bean!
It's Best Bean!
Happily, I think perhaps humorously might be closer to the truth.
So, it transpires the man fashioned a hiding place in the ceiling. What's in it? What exactly is the loot? Let us look then, if you're ready. Let's examine the late burglar's hall.
What's in it?
What the? What is that?
Oh!
Onto the Baskervilles!
A bloody dog collar?
This is how we get in the Hound of the Baskervilles.
Yeah, it looks like some sort of neckband or collar. It's a bloody dog collar.
A collar? It's huge, though.
And look at all the gemstones in it. I can see why it was planned to be worth 1,000 pounds. Perhaps I could have it as a belt.
Oh, have you noticed the inside there? There's some dark chance. Yeah, it's blood.
You don't think there could be blood, do you? I mean, there's quite a lot of it.
On second thoughts, perhaps I won't have it as a belt.
Yeah, good thinking.
Then, of course, there's this emblem here. A large letter B and a small crown.
What does it signify, do you think?
Oh, I hadn't noticed that. I feel as though I've seen that emblem somewhere before, you know? What could it have been?
That's enough of that, I think. What?
What's
the matter with Mr. Sholmes? All the color has drained from his face.
Sholmes, well, what are you on?
Well, Inspector, I believe you ought to be taking this, aren't you? It could be valuable evidence, after all. It must be kept safely under lock and key.
Ah, yes. Get your grubby arms off that, you lot, and hand it over, now!
God, everyone's getting shady around us. It's fucking weird.
I know.
I'd never seen a collar that large before. And all those jewels certainly look to be extremely valuable. But that's not what stood out the most to me, at least not once I noticed it. Those dark marks on the inside of the collar, those stains, could they really have been blood?
Well, that was a funny case, wasn't it? But it's all buttoned up now.
And you look very pleased, Iris.
I am, because I was starting to wonder what I could use as the basis of this month's story in the magazine.
Hey!
But this case will be perfect. It's been so fascinating.
You're talking about the latest installment of The Adventures of Herlock Sholmes, I presume?
The mystery of the knife in the mist, and the mustache man, the convict's curse, perhaps. We can make a two-part story! Oh, I can't wait!
What do we factor in? A word, please, Iris.
Yes, what is it, Harley?
I'm sorry, but you can't write about this case. It's out of the question.
Why?
What? Why not? It's a great case.
Then I shall have to insist that you limit yourself to the first of your two titles. The second must never be written. Is that clear?
Why?
What is... this game!
Sholmes, what are you up to?
Yes, don't cry! Don't make my skin cry!
Sholmes, you...
It was that the second of Sol Seki-san's cases became buried in obscurity. Now, looking back, I feel I understand. I can see why Mr. Sholmes forbade Iris from publishing the story. It would take a little longer before I saw the link between everything that had happened and would happen. For it wasn't until 2 months after the arrival of Susato-san's letter that events began to unfurl again, with an incident that took place at the very heart of the eagerly awaited Great Exhibition of London.
Ooh, the Great Exhibition of London!
Oh, this is getting deep!
End. Oh, next
we
week...
We did it!
Next week gonna be good. The Key of Knowledge! Yes, I'd like to save, thank you.
Oh,
we did it.
We did it. Everybody in chat, yay. Can I get 07s? We did it. We did it.
Oh, my God. We did it.
Oh, God. That's great. And next week is just going to be crazy. Good.
Yep. Next week, we begin case 3.
The adventure, the return of the great departed soul.
Yeah.
Oh, that's going to be great.
That'll be next.
That'll be next week, but this week, well, that wraps it up for this week, folks, I guess.
Yep.
We're going to get out of here, guys. Thank y'all for coming in. I will not be dropping a schedule this week as I might be taking the week off for my mental health reasons, but we will be back next Sunday. Confirmed for more Shadow Stars. Will I be streaming during the week? Depends on how I feel, but you will know for a fact we will be back next Sunday to keep this story a-going.
Yep.
So I do appreciate
bye-bye.
All right, so everybody say goodbye to Nicole. Say goodbye.
Bye-bye.
All right, and this means we need to find someone to raid. Let me check my list here. Who do I have? Let's see. Oh, my boy Digital Vagrant is streaming right now by the looks of it. Yeah, let's go raid my boy Digital Vagrant. All right, that's going to be fun. I do appreciate y'all for coming out. Again, don't know what I'll be doing this week. There will be no schedule. I might just be impromptu. So pay attention to the Discord for any or my Twitter for any announcements if I decide to go live. Just probably some chill stuff during the week. So hopefully you guys will tune in. But you know what? I do appreciate y'all coming out. Thanks for coming in, coming out. I hope you enjoyed. We're going to go raid Digital Vagrant. You guys know the deal. Once you get in there, you will spam the raid message. Henshin Club raid for life. Thank y'all for coming out. Hope y'all have a great day. I will see you all sometime this week, but I will definitely see you next Sunday for another edition of Shadow Stars. Until this boy THG, I'm getting the hell out of here. Y'all have a great night. Later!